traditional owners of the land, the Wurundjeri people, and pay my respects to elders both past and present. Moving to item one, membership. We have a few councillors on a leave of absence. Councillor Lawrence. Councillor Messina and Councillor Greco. Item two, apologies. There are no apologies. Item three, disclosures of conflicts of interest. Are there any disclosures? No? Thank you. Item four, confirmation of the minutes of council meeting.
I'd like to move those with change, if I could.
Yes.
The minutes should start at 17.112 to the last item 17.136 and not 17.285 to 17.109. If we can make those changes, I can feel like the minutes.
Thank you. Is there a seconder?
Yep.
Thank you, Councillor Amir. All those in favour? That's carried. Moving on to item five, question and submission time. I have a number of questions that have been received online that we'll go to first. First question is from Serena O'Mealy. Would you like to read out your question?
Thank you, Mayor. I'm in the unusual position of having received the answer to my questions before the meeting. So I'm in danger of preempting your responses somewhat. I'm quite concerned about the delay in the production of the report that the community is seeking about the Strathallan open space. So I'll read my questions and I hope that Council has a better response than I originally received. So the first question is, I refer to Darabin Council resolution on Strathallan open space, 13th February 2017, minute number 17063. The resolution requested an officer's report on a range of issues concerning the protection of the Strathallan open space, letters to key decision makers, and a meeting with community stakeholders. When will the officer's report be completed and made available to the public? And can the Mayor report back on outgoing and incoming correspondence relevant to the Strathallan resolution? That's the first part.
Thank you. So I'll answer those two. The report is currently being prepared and information is being sought on the history of the ownership of the land as it may impact upon the future avenues of action for Council. It's expected to be included on the agenda for the 15th of May meeting. I also, after I spoke to you last weekend, inquired with the CEO around whether councillors could be briefed sooner on the issue and so hopefully something will be coming sooner to councillors than the 15th of May.
Thank you. The second question is
The second part of that question. as a part of the resolution, letters have been sent to Latrobe and members of Parliament as per the resolution. There was a delay in sending those letters because I asked those letters to be rewritten. But so they have gone, but there's no response been received yet. And I will provide information through my mayoral column as events progress.
Next part of the question is, when will the meeting with community representatives be convened and who will be invited? Will the invitation include community groups / individuals who have expertise in the local environment and conservation? And the reason for putting that question is that it was overlooked when the motion was put up that having people with environmental expertise would be of great assistance to the council.
So the response is that the meeting will be organised once more information is gathered. So through the writing of the report, we'll get the information. And once we know what the positions of the university is, as well as the relevant minister. The resolution requested a meeting be arranged with the community stakeholders, so including Save Strathallan Open Space Community Coalition Incorporated, Springfield Owners Corporation and Strathallan Golf Club. So we'll make sure that all members of those groups are invited, but we'll ensure that will only happen once we have more information on the table. But also, Council will consider the list of attendees once the purpose of the meeting has been determined, which will be informed by those formal positions with the university. be in the ministers.
What would the university delay?
Pardon?
What would the university delay in response?
It's a good question. As I said, there was delays sending the letters to the university. It only went out, I think, early, about a week ago. So I think waiting a little bit longer is probably a courtesy to the university, but if we don't hear from them, then we will follow up and progress in our own way. Yep. Thank you. The next question is from Ben Lemon. Is Ben with us? Got noted here that he's not attending, so I'll read his question. More often than not, garbage trucks pass for collection before 6 a.m. on their scheduled day in our area, waking our baby every time. Is this a reasonable time for the residents? If someone was to play bagpipes at this time every week, I expect action would be taken. Could we implement a curfew in line with standard noise restrictions? The response from council is that we apologise for any inconvenience you may have experienced due to the waste service collection times. Council's garbage collection weeks can include some early starts in order to avoid peak traffic periods and congestion where difficult access to streets exist. Council has reviewed the collection times in your street and collections will be rescheduled to not commence prior to 6 a.m. on any given day. Next question is from Ryan Sandigan. Sandigan, sorry. Would you like to read out your question?
Sure. Thank you. What's your name? Jess. Thank you. Jess. This one here. My question is addressed to the CEO of the City of Durham, Mr. Shanahan. Mr. Shanahan, you're a highly experienced local government bureaucrat. The Local Government Act is your Bible, and the MAB Act is its Old Testament. You're well paid by ratepayers to protect their interests against the folly of an inexperienced and politically noisy council, and the legal advisers of opportunities to be high profile legal advocates. What, if any, due diligence did you exercise in the decision of the Darrell Council taken at the January 30th special meeting of Council?
Thanks for that question. Just as a reminder, all public questions need to be addressed to myself as the chairperson of the meeting and not to the CEO or council officers. So I'm happy to respond to that question on behalf of the CEO. So the observations made about Mr. Shanahan being a highly experienced and having almost encyclopedic knowledge of the Local Government Act and other local government law are very accurate. In relation to his due diligence, he is satisfied that there was nothing whatsoever to be risked or lost by council nominating Councillor Coral Ross as council's delegate to the MAB.
That doesn't constitute due diligence.
The next question is on my list is also from you. Would you like to read that out?
My question is to the CEO there at the City Council, Phil Shanahan. Mr. Shanahan, the recent application to the Supreme Court for an injunction against the MAB was made in the name of Darren Councillor Coral Ross with co-applicant. Are you prepared to give a guarantee to the city's ratepayers that Coral Ross will be made to pay half the cost of the action, including cost to council?
So again, just a reminder that the questions should be directed to the chair. And in response, no, Coral Ross was not part of his considerations in making a decision to take the matter to the Supreme Court. And Coral Ross was simply our choice as MAB delegate.
Have you read the decision?
Thank you. The next question is from Sally Mendez, who has not indicated if she's attending. She's not here, no. I'll read out her question. Moving trees and gardens, leaving a bald building block is not in the interests of the people of Darabin, the birds and insects that inhabit those trees and plants. When will the City of Darabin recognise the significant trees and private land and protect them by introducing local laws to stop clear felling of blocks? So Council values the urban forest, not just on public land, but also the significant trees on private land. Currently, there are no controls in place on the removal of significant trees from private land, and we're currently exploring the various options available to protect trees on private property. The next question is from Justin Passaportis.
Mayor, councillors, thanks for the opportunity to address council this evening. Can the council please advise what actions it is pursuing in relation to the ministerial sign-off of Planning Scheme Amendment C137? We have a developer at present seeking an amendment through VCAT at 161 to 195 High Street, D75/2011, directly contravening the spirit of C137 in height, built volume, size, and bulk, and neighborhood character. If they are successful in this amendment, it will undermine the work and effort of the council in developing C137 and essentially open the floodgate to other poor planning applications. Can the council also advise what resources it will allocate in opposing this amendment, given the significance of the amendment? Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Council officers have been actively advocating to the Department of Environment, Land, Water and Planning and the Minister's Office for a decision on Amendment C137. To date, we have not received an announcement by the Department of any impending decision on the amendment. The length of time taken to make a decision on this amendment is a concern and is certainly adding to the complexity of our tribunal hearings where applications are within the C137 area. As you would be aware, officers have assessed the amended plans for the proposal at 161 to 195 High Street, and based on the current amended plans, have sought not to support the proposal. Council will be represented at the tribunal hearing. However, who will be presenting at the hearing has not been yet determined. Also, Councillor McCarthy has foreshadowed an urgent motion that he will be moving this evening. And he will be requesting that the Mayor writes to the Minister for Planning, again advocating for him to look at approving the amendment. Mm. Next question is from Maria Poletti, and Maria doesn't look to be here this evening, so I will read out the question. Question one, why aren't substandard one-page planning applications returned to developers after the initial assessment by the planning officer? And two, alternatively, why not trigger the process to refusal based on the substandard application instead of hand-holding developers to improve their application and wasting officers' time? So the response is that council officers have on numerous occasions promptly refused planning applications where they have been assessed to be not in accordance with relevant provisions of the planning scheme, and the concerns raised by officers have not been adequately addressed. In terms of the standard of information that applicants are allowed to submit to council, Council has highlighted to the state government through several planning reform process reviews of the need to tighten performance requirements for the quality and content of planning applications lodged. The next question is Chris Erlinson, and Chris doesn't look to be with us this evening, so I'll read out his question. Question one, on behalf of the community, we would like to know who was responsible for the decision made in 2007 to not advertise stage 1B of the proposed development in relation to Preston Market, and in doing so, locking out the rights of the public. And question two, what was the rationale for making such a decision? So we'll take that question on notice and provide Chris with a written response shortly. There is one written question. It's from Giuseppe Cicchia. Is that how you pronounce it? Sorry.
It's not how you pronounce it. It's like I've been calling me names. Good evening, Mayor, CEO, councillors, and ladies and gentlemen. My name is Giuseppe, and I'm from Yarra Avenue in Reservoir. I've lived there for over 30 years and owned the property from 1972. I've taken care of the nature strip for 30 years. I can honestly say that. Currently, I have a problem that has popped up, and a person has been vandalising a portion of the nature strip, making it quite unsightly. Furthermore, every time he's actually continually scraping the dirt and the seed from the ground so the grass doesn't grow back.
He doesn't just do it on my nature strip. He's done it 70 metres on the west side of Baldwood Parade, heading north down to Yarra Avenue. He's actually ventured into the medium strip and started work there as well. Now, I don't know whether he's been employed by the council or whether he has permission to do this, but I seriously doubt it. There's no explanation as to why, no reasonable explanation as to why he's doing this. However, I have had discussions with Kate, who works here, and she's informed me that they've sent letters, and I'm now, after 6 to 8 months, I have video evidence, I have photographic evidence. This gentleman is a chronic kleptomaniac. He has council property on his own property. I referred to the garbage bins. He has, on any one time, 5 or 6 garbage bins. Mine went missing on late January, and I alleged that he stole that during the night. That's when he does his work. Now, up until now, I've been informed that letters have been sent to him. Now, obviously, you know, if you want to speak, talk him, he's just going to ignore what you send to him. And I find that a very soft stance from council. I reiterate, this is a chronic problem. If I was to scrape the dirt out the front of the council here, I'd be arrested, put in jail, and treated like a criminal. This is criminal damage, and under the Government Law Act 2015, the actual CEO has permission to exercise his discretion and deliver or send to him a notice to comply. If he does not comply, there are a number of credits, up to 10, each credit being $100 in fine, and I believe that he should be responsible to replace the lawns that he has taken away. Mm. They have become a hazard. He also has debris, bricks falling from his fence, where young children, you've got Reservoir East Primary School right across the road, they have to negotiate.
Just asking you to come to your question, sorry.
Yeah, yeah. My question is, do you support vandalism?
No, I don't, and I believe that my fellow councillors do not support vandalism. I'm really sorry to hear about what has happened. I will be referring this matter directly to the CEO to investigate and hopefully come to a resolution. And hopefully we can get the matter resolved shortly. But it's really, must be hard. It's been, you mentioned that it's been 6 to 8 months that this has been occurring.
And it's just been 6 to 8 months that it's popped up.
Yeah.
He's never done
yes.
any work on the property. That's been mine, and I've been quite happy to do that.
Yes.
But the stance that you've taken, that has been taken by Darabin City Council,
yes.
is been soft.
Yeah. And I think that that's evident by the time, you know, it has 6 to 8 months has passed, and I think that an issue like this should have been resolved in that time. So again, I'll be taking the question on notice and getting the CEO to follow it up, and hopefully we'll be able to come to a resolution. Thank you.
Fine, thank you very much.
Are there any other further questions or state submissions?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Madam Mayor, are you aware that people from the north are asking shopkeepers at Johnson Street, Keon Park, can they use their toilets as there's no public toilet there? Are you aware of that?
No, I wasn't aware.
All right, Madam Mayor, people in the north, northern end of the city, have nowhere to go if they wish to go to the toilet. Council officers have advised that Johnson Street shops, as a local or minor retail centre and public toilets are not required. The public toilets in Donoff Reserve are only open when there is games or events held. Following the completion or construction of Donoff Reserve, toilets will be reassessed if the current opening hours match the council use. Madam Mayor, let's not forget also that the council pulled in a perfectly good toilet in Batman Park and replaced it with another public toilet at a cost to the ratepayer of $121,000. Madam Mayor, how about you and your council treat the people in the north with respect and courtesy and give us a public toilet or open up the park now? Why should they have to suffer when there's no public toilet available?
Thank you for your question. Again, I'll have to take this one on notice because I don't know much about, as I said, I didn't know that there weren't public toilets accessible, and refer it to the officers. And as a part of the Donathan Dole master planning process, perhaps with the activation of the area and that parkland, it would actually mean that the public toilets need to be open for a longer period of time. So we will refer that on and get a response to you for you.
If we're feeding him as a council, this problem could be resolved tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody will make a decision and say open up the parklands or the public toilets in the pavilions, which are closed, only except, as I said earlier, just for game times or event. This could be quite easily done. At the moment, if a person wants to go to the toilet, use their bowels, or wants to do anything else, they've got nowhere to go, they've got to jump in their car or walk home in agony.
Mm.
So let's have our doing something about it.
Yeah, no, thank you. Thank you for raising that. Are there any other questions? No? Okay, we'll move on. So item 6, consideration of reports. Item 6.1, technical and pre-feasibility study, Bell Street Little Crossing removal. Now, as a part of our new arrangements to opening up council meetings, those who have registered to submit before we consider this item are free to do so now, and we have one person, Bo Lee. So you'll have 2 minutes to address the council on this item.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, and councillors. Thank you for the opportunity to address the council. It's a very innovative initiative to have this, and I'll take the opportunity. I understand and I congratulate the council's evidence-based approach in making the report public regarding the grain separations at Bell Street, and I fully support, from my perspective, the right over option, as it offers the most comprehensive benefit to the community throughout the precinct, from Murray Road right down to Oak Harbour Road, and it will free up the traffic flow around the area and will benefit enormously of residents living around the railway precinct. I do have 3 requests for the council to consider if council is going down this path. First of all, I wish the council to initiate discussions with BigTrack as soon as possible to enter into a perpetual lease of the land affected by the rail level crossing removal, so that it can be the head tenant of that land. Secondly, should number one prove to be successful, that the council to convene a community working group of some sort as soon as possible, so that the land can be used for community benefit in conjunction with the community. And thirdly, should one or two succeed, the council to allocate appropriate resources within this current budget and future budgets on a master plan basis to beautify the area with capital works for both street furniture, greening of the space, and also capital improvements upgrade for the area, because the residents deserve no less. Thank you.
Thank you, Bo. Okay, so we have the recommendation in front of us, councillors.
I'd like to move to support.
Thank you, Councillor Newton. Is there a seconder?
Yeah.
Thank you, Councillor Williams. Councillor Newton.
Thank you, Mayor. So this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for Preston and Darabin, and I fully support the position we are taking on elevated rail to get 4 level crossings removed in Preston rather than just 1. I commend our officers for being proactive and eliciting expert analysis on how the best outcomes can be achieved for our community. I believe they've showed leadership and done their homework to get towards the outcome they've recommended. I'm excited about the opportunity to remove the level crossings at Bell Street, Oakover Road, Cramer Street and Murray Road all at the same time and to provide such a great outcome for the area. The report says that over the next 20 years, it's predicted that an 80% increase in traffic demand will occur in Darabin. Level cross removals will help. The benefits include opportunities for more open space, new walking and cycling paths, and removing barriers between East and West Preston. I believe this project will be transformative for Preston with results such as safer pedestrian access to the Darabin Arts Entertainment Centre and Ray Bremmel Gardens. It'll also have benefits such as allowing for improvements of bypass connecting to the CBD. I'm keen for Council to work collaboratively with State Government and the LRXA to get the best outcome for our residents and for generations to come. I hope the community will come along with us on this journey. As the report says, without a strong advocacy position from Council and our community, there's a significant risk no further level crossing will be delivered as part of this project. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Williams.
I just want to say a big thank you to the previous Council officers that undertook its own research to determine what else they could be done to maximise the positive outcomes for this community. The Victorian Government is committed to the removal of the crossings at the Grange Road, Bell Street, High Street, which will stimulate significantly for business growth, employment and business benefits and of course better public transport. The planning process was aimed to identify the most beneficial scale and forms of this rail crossing grade separation. We've done our homework and we've developed a proposal that will deliver community, economic and environmental benefits. Council's in full support of elevated rail solution to remove not one, but three additional level crossings on the South Morang line. Our proposal including expanding the Bell Street Preston level crossing removal to include removal of three additional crossings at Oakover Road, Murray Road and Cramer Street through an elevated rail solution package of work, which could never feasibly be removable if a trench option is selected. An elevated rail option will cost less and less disruptive to existing rail services than a lowered rail option. Elevated rail only requires the moving of the bridge footing as opposed to using lowered rail, which is a wide trench required. Possibility of evacuation due to poor contaminated soil using lowered rail was not considered economically feasible, so therefore this option was discarded. An elevated rail solution will deliver better public transport for Preston. It will create new safe areas for cyclists and new pedestrian paths, playgrounds, community gardens. This proposal will deliver economic and environmental benefits. It will also enable for far greater car spaces availability and bus interchange facilities at the stations.
Thank you, Councillor Williams. Any other speakers? Councillor Amin.
I'm really excited about this proposal. As Councillor Newton said, this is an opportunity that doesn't come along every day. It's exciting for a few reasons. One is because the train line is so crucial for us here in Darabin, but it does provide a physical barrier, and the opportunity to open up that barrier is certainly very exciting. And the fact that it's a win-win-win situation for all transport users, for walking, cycling, cars, and train users, and with the added benefit of the space that would be generated underneath what's currently the train line. And I certainly say thank you very much to Bo Lee for his idea of the community reference group to work on what we can do in that space, because it is a lot of space and there is so much that can be done, and I am certainly very excited about if we can pull this off to work with the state government to have council have leadership over that land. It's certainly something we can do to realise a lot of the ideas that we've had and address a lot of the challenges that have happened in regards to traffic congestion and the like. I'd also like to echo the words of previous councillors of the many thanks to the forward thinking of the officers who've worked so hard on this, and it makes me really proud to be part of a council where we're not just being reactive but we're being on the front foot and showing leadership, which the state government has responded so positively to.
Thank you. Further speakers? Councillor Rennie.
Yes, I too would like to commend the work of the officers who have proactively gone about thinking about how to achieve a fantastic outcome for the City of Darabin. Level crossings get in the way of transport, they're unsafe, they hold up trains, they hold up cars, and ultimately we need a lot more trains on the South Main train line. These level crossings are going to become even more important tomorrow than they are today. But not only do we have an opportunity here to improve traffic and increase the number of trains on the line, we have an opportunity, thanks to the report from our council officers, to advocate strongly to state government to invest additional resources above the promised level crossing removal at Bell Street and to make sure that we're in the strongest position possible to get them to fund level crossing removals at Cramer Street and Murray Road. That's not something we'd get if we were dragged kicking or screaming if we weren't proactive, and I really think that we need to acknowledge the work that's been done by council officers over some time in identifying this extraordinary opportunity. And it's extraordinary not only because of the improved traffic solutions that we'll get, but because we will end up with 2 MCGs worth of connected green open spaces, improving livability in this area, improving access to public open space and walkability around the whole area for residents for kilometres, all the way from Thornbury Station up close to Regent. People will feel the benefits of this. And I think that would be an extraordinary outcome. I believe this report has positioned us very, very well to advocate to the state government to actually pursue this option. Indeed, I think this report makes any other option look foolish. And I think that that puts us in a great position to work effectively with the state government.
Thank you. Councillor McCarthy?
Before I speak, Mayor, I'd just like to propose a point 12, which would read as follows. And this is picking up on the comments by Mr. Lee. Point 12 receives a further report on proposed terms of reference and a recruitment process for a community reference group to work alongside council in relation to the potential amenity benefits from this project. So I propose that to the mover and seconder to be added.
Yes, that's fine.
Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll provide that to officers.
Thank you.
I'd like to speak in favour of the motion. I'd like to also, though, draw to Council's attention what I consider is a glaring flaw in the report. And it's a flaw which it's not a technical flaw, but it's one of authorship. And I'd like to actually acknowledge former Darabin Councillor Bo Lee for actually putting this issue on Darabin Council's agenda back in 2013. Until then, the proposal to remove the Bell Street level crossing was not on our agenda. It was not on the agenda of the state government. It was not on the agenda, in fact, of the public transport authorities or the RACV or any other body. In fact, it was Bo Lee, in fact, put this to council as a notice of motion back in 2013. And I think we need to acknowledge that work back then that initiated council's work, council's campaign in 2014 to the state government to look at level crossing removals, and of course the Great Northern Bikeway project, and significantly the maintenance of that position all the way through. It's going to be a wonderful time when this project actually goes ahead, and hopefully in the incarnation that we've proposed here as per the report. But we need to remember that this is something that in fact has come from this council chamber by a former councillor, and I think we owe it to Bo Lee to recognise that initiative, because it simply would not be happening had that not been pushed from the start. So thank you, Bo. I also would like to echo Councillor Rennie's comments about the 2 MCGs worth of new green open space that will be provided as part of this project. And this is in fact probably one of the strongest arguments from a local community perspective, not just obviously the east-west improvements and of course the high frequency rail possibilities along the South Morang line, but in fact the local amenity, which is going to be significantly improved, particularly for people who live adjacent to the train line, who will no longer have rail yards, but in fact will hopefully have basketball nets, green open space, parklands and walking tracks. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Everyone has now spoken, so I will put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Thank you. Item 6.2, Notice of Intention to Declare Reservoir Village Business District Special Rate Levy.
I'd like to move the motion.
Thank you, Councillor Newton. And a seconder?
I'm happy to second.
Thank you, Councillor Rennie. Councillor Newton.
So, Reservoir Village is a great spot on Edward Street and home to iconic reservoir institutions such as Il Pasticcino and Sargent's Cakes. I see from the report that the special rate for marketing, promotion and development of this business district has been going since 1999, and that's what's before us is basically about extending this for 5 years. Reservoir is changing rapidly for the better, and I hope that this special rate can help Reservoir Village thrive into the future while not losing what's great about the area already. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Rennie.
Nothing further.
Thank you. I might put that to the vote if everybody's happy. All those in favour? Carried unanimously. Item 6.3, Preston Market Parking Agreement.
I'm happy to move that.
Thank you, Councillor Rennie. And seconded, Councillor McCarthy. Councillor Rennie.
This is a recommendation to effectively extend the current parking agreement for Preston Market for an additional 3-month period. Parking at Preston Market, we all know, has been difficult, and I'm sure that whilst the situation has calmed somewhat, there may be community members who feel as though we're doing it right. The fact is we can't keep changing a regime. The more we change a regime, the more we confuse community members, which will result in more infringement notices. And we do need to have parking restrictions at the market, because with no parking restrictions, we will end up with a giant car park for all-day commuters, and there will be no access to the market for people who are there to do their shopping. So that's not what the traders want. We do need restricted parking. I note that some people have been fined because they have overstayed the 2 hours, and that is a perfectly reasonable thing that you would encounter anywhere where there is 2-hour parking if you choose to stay longer than 2 hours. Whilst it's never nice to get a ticket, that is a choice people are making, and I think that we have been actually very fair to the community in this regard. There have been a lot of attempts to convey in many different ways and through many different mediums the situation. So I think that extending this for a further 3-month period, while perhaps we look at a more global picture of what the future might be, think about something. I'd be very reluctant to have any interim arrangements. I think they're detrimental to the community's understanding. And on that basis, I'm moving this motion.
Thank you. Councillor McCarthy.
Look, I don't have a great deal to add. I think Councillor Rennie has made the crucial point here, though, which is that if we are to support the traders and support the continuation of Preston Market, and, of course, the capacity for locals and people, in fact, beyond this area to be able to actually shop there, then we need to actually ensure that there is some enforcement of the parking arrangements which actually protects the capacity for people to actually shop there. It is a very easy thing, with so much demand for the train service along the South Morang line, for people to come and park there all day at Preston Market and in fact, use up those car spots which are really there to support the traders and to support that trade. So I think this is the very reasonable way forward. Obviously, the first 2 hours being free continues to be part of the proposal, but I would be very reluctant to change the arrangements at the moment. There's been so much confusion from the previous arrangements. This council took a very principled position in terms of returning any monies that were taken and any fines that were issued during a certain period during the confusion. Not everyone agrees with that, and that's fine, but we felt that it was the fair and right thing to do, and I think that this is the fair and right thing to do by the traders in terms of continuing to ensure that there is parking available for local shoppers to get to Preston Market.
Thank you. Any further speakers? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Item 6.4, appointment of independent member of the Audit Committee.
I'm happy to move that recommendation.
Thank you, Councillor Rennie. Is there a seconder? Thank you, Councillor Amir. Councillor Rennie.
Thank you. This is a report that we've received and a recommendation that we not take up an option to extend the appointment of Mr. Michael Seed as the external auditor for Council's Audit Committee. And I think that it's timely for Council to revisit the composition of the Audit Committee, and I say that because it's good governance to actually regularly look at how you do things and to change over sometimes. We thank Mr. Sayed for his contribution to the Audit Committee over the last 4 years, but in order to stay fresh and to have new ideas and to adequately scrutinise everything that comes before us, not in a way we may have always done, but in fact to look for new opportunities in the Audit and Risk Committee so that we can stay sharp, so that we can keep ahead of the game, I suppose, and identify new ways of doing it, a change will be a very useful thing. So on that basis, I'm speaking in favour of the recommendation and note that we will get a new member, and I think that will bring some new ideas and new vigour into the process of thinking about how we identify risks within council, how we undertake audit processes, and make sure that they're not just routine, but that they actually achieve better governance outcomes and better vision for the way Darabin looks to the future and manages risk and other issues.
Thank you, Councillor Ramey.
I think further, Ray.
Thank you. I'll put that to vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Item 6.5, 2016-17 Capital Works Quarter 3 Budget Review.
So moved.
Yeah. Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. In the seconder? Thank you, Councillor Ramey. Councillor McCarthy.
Thank you, Mayor. This is an item which comes to us generally around this time of the year in relation to the financial processes that we must undertake when looking at the budget position. I would have to say, though, in my time on this council, I've never seen such a detailed report in relation to how we deal with projects that cannot be completed in the current financial year, projects which will be completed in the next financial year, and how we are as transparent as possible in relation to what money can't be spent in the timeframe, what money can be spent, and where the opportunities are to actually ensure that certain projects that were at risk of not being able to be funded can actually go ahead. There is a lot of detail in this report, and I would just draw to Councillor's attention the fact that it's in the order of around $6 million in terms of project difference. That is generally the case in terms of the carry forward from year to year, but you have a level of detail in this report which I've never seen, and I think that's a really great sign from a councillor perspective, but also from a community perspective. I would draw to council's attention, though, that there are some instances where we expected to receive some external funding which has not been received, and in those cases, council has stepped in and funded the difference. And in a couple of cases as well, there have been opportunities, such as the provision of new netball courts in the city of Darabin, where we've seen the opportunity to move forward and to provide that funding through some of these savings that have been made. Overall, there's close to $450,000 that will be saved over the course of the current financial year, and that is a terrific outcome in terms of efficiencies, and in many cases where tenders came in lower than expected. So all that money is returned back into the next budget process to ensure that that is delivering capital works programs. I won't go through project by project, but I would say a thanks to our officers for working very hard in terms of trying to find those savings and getting that to us in a time when we can adopt these variations. And as I said again, this is the first time we've had such a detailed report.
Thank you. Councillor Ramey.
This is a report that I think is certainly commendable in regards to transparency, as mentioned by Councillor McCarthy. Often we get questions from members of the public as councillors where people are asking, what's happened to this project? Why hasn't it happened yet? Is it still on the agenda? And this is a really clear and easy way for people to see some of those projects that they're still remaining on the agenda. And also another question we sometimes get asked is about how can council save more money? How can you do more with what you've got? And this is another way that we can see that, where the staff here are working hard to try to get better value. For me, this is a little bit of a taster of things to come. As we know, we've got the draft budget coming to us in several weeks' time. We've already had consultation processes and ward meetings around that. And I hope that people can look at this and get some ideas and get excited about everything we've got coming in that budget for the next financial year.
Thank you. Any further speakers? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Item 6.6, proposed road discontinuance adjoining 2 and 4 Combi Street and 13 South Street, Preston. Thank you, Councillor Williams. And a seconder? Thank you, Councillor Weir. Councillor Williams.
This is a discontinuance of land. It's a normal process that we go through. It's a statutory process under the section 206 and clause 3. It's a discontinuance of a road joining 2 and 4 Combi Street and 13 South Street. All it does, and all we're saying here today, that we will be giving notice to publication in our newspaper and on our website to give notice that we're selling that land and it will be no longer discontinued.
Thank you, Councillor Ramey.
Nothing further.
Thank you. I'll put that to vote. All those in favour? Carried unanimously. Item 6.7, proposed discontinuance rear 47 and 49 Darabin Boulevard and 66 Dundee Street Reservoir.
I'll move.
Thank you, Councillor Newton. And seconder, Councillor McCarthy. Councillor Newton.
So similar to the last one, this is a straightforward statutory matter and no submissions or objections were received to the notification of the change in September. So this just means the road will be discontinued and sold by public treaty.
and one of the members has expressed interest in purchasing the land, so I'd say it's quite straightforward. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor McCarthy?
Nothing to add.
Thank you. I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? It's carried unanimously. Item 6.8, proposed sale of council land adjoining rear of 4 Grandview Road and 3 Grange Street, Preston. Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. And a seconder, Councillor Rennie. Councillor McCarthy.
Look, as per previous items in this case, this is a piece of land which is actually very close here to Town Hall, and I will just draw to Council's attention the recommendation on page 57, which is commencing the statutory procedures in relation to this item.
Thank you. Councillor Rennie.
Look, just briefly I might add that I think whilst some people might think, you know, selling council lands is something we should do, continuing to hold small parcels of laneway in council ownership actually results in risk to council, it results in costs to council, and it also results in a situation where people might want to subdivide at some stage and think that those little parcels of rear laneway could be accessed and enable them to subdivide and build more properties. So to that extent, I think that sometimes the sale of these and the cessation of them as laneways not only reduces costs to council and risk, but also perhaps means that they won't be used in the future to see possibly undesirable developments that rely on unsuitable laneways for access.
Thank you. Any further speakers? Put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Item 6.9, Seniors Home Gardening Program Update. Thank you, Councillor Amir. And seconder, Councillor McCarthy. Councillor Amir.
So this is an issue that I understand has been a long-standing interest of this council, originating before this council under the previous council. The recommendation is quite straightforward in terms of noting the report, and I suspect this is an issue that we'll continue to discuss and make further decisions on as part of the broader consideration of aged care services in response to the change in funding from the federal government and the new aged care funding model.
Thank you. Councillor McCarthy.
The only thing I'd add, obviously, is that we're in the process of reviewing and looking to how we can retain home care, particularly for our ageing population, who in fact have a much higher concentration in the northern part of our city. And so I'm really pleased that we have actually set up a working group which is comprised of councillors and relevant officers to actually look at these issues in detail. Councillor Greco had proposed that, I believe, and is not with us this evening, but I think he would also support this proposal, which is to look at this program in the context of all the services, because we want to make sure that we're providing people with the services that they need as they age in place. And that's a big part of our future focus, but also our focus on our ageing population.
Thank you. Any further speakers? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? It's carried unanimously. Moving on to item 7, consideration of responses to petitions, notices of motion and general business. There is nil. Item 9, notices of motion. There are none. That was item 8. Item 9, urgent business. There are 3 urgent business items I have listed.
I'm moving 2 items. The first one, Mayor, which should appear on screen, is in relation to the Adani coal mine.
So is there a seconder to accept this item onto the agenda?
So move that the item which has been circulated to councillors is accepted.
Thank you, Councillor Amir. All those in favour of accepting this item onto the agenda? That's carried. Councillor McCarthy.
Thank you, Mayor.
We just get a seconder for that motion now.
Yep.
Councillor Amir, thank you. Councillor McCarthy.
Sure. I think I'll just make sure that the correct words are there, yes. All right, so councillors would be aware of the Adani coal mine proposal and of course the national campaign in relation to this item. In relation to the relevance within the Darabin context, there are some very interesting situations that face all councils. The most significant, of course, is can we be sure that that our dollars, our ratepayers' dollars, are not going towards funding this coal mine. And in fact, in the current setting, we can't be sure of that, because Darabin Council, under its current investment policy, has some accounts held with the Westpac Bank and the Bank of Melbourne. And both banks, of course, has been reported, looking at their involvement with this particular project, which of course is a great concern of ours and those other organisations that we work closely with, because this coal mine, if allowed to proceed, will have a significant impact, and in a very negative sense, in terms of global emissions and, of course, Australia's emissions in terms of greenhouse gases, and significantly makes it very hard for us as a country and also as a community more generally to actually achieve serious and real action on climate change. And there are obviously very specific effects on our own natural settings. So what this motion does, and I will just acknowledge that the Mayor is the author of this motion, and I'm moving this on her behalf this evening, is takes us that next step to say, can we look at removing our investment with the banks, in this case Westpac and Bank of Melbourne, who have involvement with this particular project. We do have a divestment policy here at the City of Darebin. It was adopted last year. It also has some conflict with our investment policy. And so what the motion also does is says, let's clear up those contradictions. Let's make sure that not a single dollar of Darebin ratepayers' money is going towards something which is fundamentally both harmful to the planet, but also harmful to our action on climate change, and hence some very specific actions in relation to our investment policy in that regard. Significantly, we will also be writing, this, if this motion is supported and adopted, writing to the relevant members of Parliament and our fellow Naga councils and the other greenhouse alliances which we are a part of, both in Victoria and potentially in other states as well, asking them to undertake the same process. We have a very strong history here in the City of Darebin taking action on environmental matters, both local and also in a broader context. And in this case, it's been the very clear decision by a number of organisations already to say that they do not want to be doing business with a bank who is doing business with a project like this. And that's the principled stance that I think our community expects. I would also note for councillors' awareness that it's been reported on a few occasions that the City of Darebin has the highest concern around climate change in Australia in terms of being a municipality. That is a significant responsibility that we hold in terms of taking a leadership position in relation to these issues. So I commend the motion and I thank the Mayor for her authorship of it.
Thank you, Councillor Amir.
So I'd say that many people in this room would agree that Adani is a disaster in regards to in the environmental impacts. It's also a really big step backwards. I would hope that in Australia we can be looking towards the future, and building a new coal mine certainly is not that. So the Stone Age didn't end because we ran out of stone, and so the Coal Age shouldn't end when we ran out of coal. We can end it now. We have other ways of producing electricity, and so we should. And here in Darebin, we don't have the power to stop the Adani mine, but we can say that we don't want to be a part of it. And I don't want to be a part of it. Darebin Council has said previously they don't want to be a part of it through the divestment policy that was put forward last council. And similarly, the people of Darebin have spoken pretty loud and clear about wanting action on climate change. This is one way that we can do that through the choices in how we make financial decisions. And I'm very pleased that this has been put forward.
Thank you. Are there further speakers? No, if not, I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Thank you. The next urgent business item is in regards to Amendment C137.
So I'll move that that be accepted onto the agenda.
Thank you. Is there a seconder? To be included. Thank you. Councillor Amir? all those in favour? That's carried. Councillor McCarthy, the item is up on the screen.
Yep.
Is there a
so
seconder?
I'll move that. Yep.
Is there a seconder? Thank you. Councillor Amir, Councillor McCarthy.
Thank you, Councillor Amir. A bit of procedural there to get through.
Sorry.
Look, this item arises from a question that was raised in the chamber earlier by a Preston resident who lives adjacent to the proposed dwelling, the proposed development, which I would note officers have recommended not supporting. It is heading to VCAT, and in doing so, it draws to our attention the glaring problem that we have right now in the City of Darebin, which is that a piece of work, a piece of a planning scheme amendment, C137, which was in fact adopted by this council 2 years ago and forwarded to the minister, remains on the minister's desk. This is the minister for planning. And because the minister has not approved this particular planning scheme amendment, it currently creates a situation where this proposal, which increases the height of a current permit from 6 storeys to 8 storeys, can be considered by both council and VCAT. That should not be the case. The work has been done. Council has made the investment in a structural plan and set of planning controls, and they need to be signed off by the minister. So because that has not been signed off by the minister, these sorts of high and mighty applications that are low in quality, in fact, do not even correspond with the Minister's own edict in regard to apartment sizes, are actually up for consideration. Now, this may be refused at VCAT, and I hope it is. It certainly should not be approved, but it should not even be allowed to be considered. And it's actually ratepayers' money that's being wasted by this situation, because we are having to go and defend our position when, in fact, this should have been ruled out had the Minister signed off on our planning scheme amendment. It's not too late. This is sitting on his desk, and it is time to sign off C137 to support the position that Council has taken in relation to controlling the heights in both this location and in other places. And in this case, the residents expect that sort of action, and it's a reasonable thing to ask for. We obviously also call upon local MPs to get behind and support the adoption of C137 into the Darabin planning scheme, so we can deliver certainty to both the residents who live there, obviously developers and applicants, to know that these are the limits, and that we're not going to be approving things beyond them. And of course, to the community more generally, to have confidence in the planning process, that when we adopt a planning scheme amendment and we send it to the Minister in a nice shiny envelope, that it actually is given the authority that it deserves, and that residents don't have to go through the heartache of taking off days upon days of work to fight an application that should not be considered at VCAT. And in fact, that's all we're asking for, is some fairness and due process, and we really hope the Minister heeds our call.
Thank you, Councillor Amin.
I'd just like to second the comments made by Councillor McCarthy. It's very challenging when residents come to us and say, this is being built next door to us, it's inappropriate for all these reasons, and we say, yes, we agree, and we don't have the law behind us to be able to defend those decisions in every case. And as was mentioned, what ends up happening is that residents put a lot of time and effort and energy into fighting this together alongside with Council, putting ratepayers' money into funding this work to have to come before VCAT, where a decision might be made one way or the other, when it should be very clearly, if it's not appropriate, it's not appropriate. One of the examples that was mentioned by one of the residents who was here earlier in the meeting was talking about a building where six stories had been approved and their new plans were put forward to try to cram seven or eight stories worth of apartments into that same six stories worth of space just by compressing the ceilings of all of the apartments below. This is not the kind of thing that we want to see. We want to have alignment between the community expectations, what we're delivering here in the chamber, and what is good practice for good health outcomes and planning outcomes for our community.
Thank you. Any further speakers? Councillor Reddy?
Can I suggest a small amendment to the mover and seconder, which is that in point two, we write that such applications are resulting in apartment size and quality that is not in keeping with the Minister's own better apartment
size. The mover and seconder happy
to accept those words? Thank you.
Would anyone else like to speak to this motion? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. The third urgent business item I have is in relation to appointing the independent chairperson for the CEO Employment Matters Committee. There was a report circulated. Yes, sir?
Yes, I'll move that, but I might also move that be accepted onto the agenda.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Councillor Rennie and Councillor McCarthy. All those in favour to accept onto the agenda, that's carried. And you would like to move the motion. Thank you, Councillor Rennie, and seconded. Councillor McCarthy, Councillor Rennie.
I'm delighted to move this motion, which would see us appoint Mary Crooks as the independent chair of the CEO Recruitment and Employment Committee. And I think this is an important role that will help us ensure that as a council we hold our future CEO to the highest standards, and that we have an independent person to actually guide us through that process. We've had a rigorous recruitment process for that independent chairperson, and by consensus have established that Mary Crooks is the best applicant for this role, given her lengthy experience, her credibility, and the high regard in which she's held in our local community and more broadly within Victoria. I think she is someone who has a terrific idea of the values that we want to see carried forward in this council. I think she will also hold us as councillors to account in this process, and that's important. And I think she will offer frank and fearless advice to us, and all of us should be open to that frank and fearless advice.
Mm.
So I'm delighted that Mary has offered or put her name in the ring. I further note that she has volunteered that she would prefer to have the payment for her services on this committee paid to the Victorian Women's Trust. And I think that is very credible, and I'm absolutely delighted that not only are we appointing the highest calibre applicant, but that council money will actually support such a wonderful organisation as the Victorian Women's Trust.
Thank you. Councillor McCarthy.
Not sure what there is left to say. I endorse everything that Councillor Rennie said, and I'd also just bring to councillors' attention, obviously, that the CEO recruitment process that we are going to undertake is unlike anything that has ever been undertaken here in the city of Darebin, and I would say actually probably in the local government sector, because we are in fact looking at a significant amount of engagement both with our community advisory committees, other members of the public and of course council staff, with a view to really building the best possible understanding of what we need in our next CEO. And whilst we really value the work that Mr. Shanahan's doing with us, he can't stay with us forever. And so we do need to have a process that is rigorous, that typifies those values that Councillor Rennie pointed out, and obviously also has an eye on finding someone who is going to be able to work collaboratively, not just with councillors and staff, but also with the community as well, because there is an incredible enabling role that a CEO can have in a local government organisation. I'm very pleased, and in fact I'm over the moon that Mary Crooks has put her name forward, and knowing her work with Watermark and a range of other campaigns and activities over the years, of course her roles with the Victoria Women's Trust and various other initiatives, you'd be hard pressed to find someone who has such a breadth and diversity of experience, but also a deep understanding of the values of this city and what we'd need in an organisational leader. So on that basis I wholeheartedly support and second the appointment.
Thank you. Further speakers? If not, I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Are there any other urgent business items? No? That's it. Moving on to item 10, general business. There is none. Item 11, petitions. Councillor Newton.
Yes, so I wish to move a motion that the petition be referred to the Chief Executive Officer for consideration and response.
Would you like to read out what the petition is about?
Yes, I am. Sorry, it's the first time I've been doing this. So, this petition that I've got here was organised by Adela Marino of Reservoir. It contains 26 signatures, all from residents of Kelvin Street and Reservoir, which is 80% of homes in that street that have signed this petition. And in terms of what it's about, it reads, "We, the undersigned residents of Kelvin Street Reservoir, petition and call on Darebin City Council the right to ask for a review of the panel member's decision to reconsider the appeal granted regarding a dangerous dog order to the dog residing at number 3 Kelvin Street Reservoir in relation to an unprovoked attack and kill of a resident's pet asleep in its owner's own property on December 6, 2016. We propose a dangerous dog order to be reviewed and to be issued to the owner. This is due to the fact the dog was roaming the street and entered the private property of a nearby resident, resulting in an unprovoked kill of another animal, as well as known previous occasions of rushing and attempting to harm other animals. It's the council's duty of care to its residents and victims of dog attacks to ensure that the concerns are taken into consideration and that dog owners' rights are not put ahead of community safety. This request is in line with the overarching purpose of the domestic animals legislation, which is to secure the safety of the public. Thank you."
Thank you. Is there a seconder? Thank you, Councillor Rennie. All those in favour? That's carried unanimously. Are there any other petitions? No. Item 12, reports of standing committees. There are none. Item 13, records of assemblies of councillors held, 13.1. Thank you, Councillor Amir and Councillor Williams, seconder. All those in favour? That's carried. Item 14, reports by Mayor and councillors. There should be a copy at your place. Thank you, Councillor Williams, and a seconder. Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. All those in favour? That's carried. Item 15, consideration of reports considered confidential.
I'd like to move that we move into camera.
Thank you. Is there a seconder? Thank you, Councillor Williams. All those in favour? That's carried. Thank you.